Good morning. I'm Jack Rickard, and this is Electric Vehicle Television. I'm here on Saturday morning today for the Friday show.
We are.
With my compadre and consigliere, El Brino Noto.
We're just slightly tardy, but we did have some guests yesterday, so.
We did.
That kind of got the afternoon rolling, and it got away from us. It was 6:30 before we kind of looked up.
We had a visit with a young man named Michael Schooley.
Schooley, yes.
From the United Kingdom about becoming EVTV UK.
Yes.
Still pending. We're still talking to him, but it's possible we'll have one there at some point. And Edwin Miller, who's doing a Agni motorcycle.
Oh, is that what he's using the cells for?
He came to pick up some CA60s, but he's in the solar business now. Lives entirely off-grid.
Oh, really? Wow.
And we did a little design talk about the EVTV 25-kilowatt solar system from hell.
All right.
Ameren UE offers a $2 per watt rebate on completion up to 25 kilowatts. I think we're going to be 24,400.
Okay, up to.
And so that's like $48,800 to do it.
Ka-ching.
That expires December 31st, 2013.
Yes.
Drops to
$1.50.
$1.50 after. And so we're going to have to get started on our solar thing. We've replaced our roof with a white rubber membrane roof.
Yeah, that's cool. Yep.
Courtesy of Flat Roof Ready.
Flat Roof Ready.
And Ed was up to try to sell us on the concept of a solar roof. And he didn't know how easy it was going
Little
to
did he know.
So he took home a check. He's a big man on campus there in the solar company.
I bet he is.
As an installer.
I bet.
He just brought home a $63,000 sale. And but Ameren UE is going to cover the bulk of that. And we're going to do some shows about that. And eventually tie that in with battery banks and fast charge and so forth in the coming year. There's going to be more EVTV to come.
Yes, barely stop us.
In the meanwhile, I'll try to be up Sunday afternoon anyway. Do we have any news from the intra-blogosphere?
We do. I this week, that wasn't too bad for news.
Mm-hmm.
Just a quick one. We always have to talk about Tesla because it is TSLA TV as well.
Mm-hmm.
Their stock, I guess, went to a record on Friday, 185.83, and then closed at 184.40.
Deutsche Bank raised their target to $200.
Yes.
If you want further mirth, refer to my blog, treated with gales of laughter. That if it's titled, if you like 140, how do you feel about a $200 Tesla? We came within $14.17 Friday. And I think we'll hit $200. Again, kind of a momentum play. At this point, we have some people who got rather wealthy on Tesla stock.
Yes.
And it's created Tesla... Tesla millionaire envy.
And Teslamonium.
And Teslamonium. And so the other thing about Tesla, well, two, there's a lot of press about General Motors going after Tesla with a $30,000 200-mile car.
Yes,
this
yes.
This is ridiculous.
Yeah. We won't have to talk about this one here.
Yeah. the press picked up on it, was trying to make something out of this. It was a very vague allusion to the future. There is no program.
No.
There is no car. There's no plans for a car. Speaking generally, when the batteries get better, they'll go after that. It's General Motors is right now in total disarray on this whole electric thing. And Tesla is mostly the cause of it. The other one is Elon just can't let it go, can he? He's got to talk about the future.
Yes, the future.
What's the next greatest, latest thing on Tesla?
Let's see. What was it here? Did I have something else about Tesla?
Yes, his autonomous car.
Oh, yeah, that he had made a claim of an autonomous car that these, in fact, set himself as jumping out ahead of Google, since they can't seem to get a partner to do their autonomous car, then he's just moving forward. And stated that doing the autonomous car at 100% autonomy is the killer, that the last 5% or 10% of that would be almost undoable.
So that it would also be the part that would kill you.
Yes, exactly.
I'd like to see an autonomous car that would wash itself.
Yeah, there you go.
I don't care about it driving itself, but if it would wash itself, yes, that would be cool. Right. If it would dump out all the chicken boxes out of the floor, that would be cool.
Yes.
If it would plug itself in, that would be nice.
Yes.
And if it would come and get me, that would be cool.
Yes, with a wake-up call.
Yeah, come out of their garage and pick me up at the porch. That would be nice. A car that drives itself. Actually, he is more realistically talking about an autopilot mode. Mm-hmm.
Yes, right.
In flying the airplanes, I'm a very busy plane captain before the takeoff and during the takeoff. Once you get up to altitude, you kind of put on the autopilot, get you a cup of coffee and a Camel, and kick back. Yeah. Of course, it's a big sky. You don't quite have the traffic.
Not all that traffic.
But I could see that being attractive on the freeway and somewhat dangerous. If I had a 17-inch screen to watch Dr. Phil on, or Wheeler Dealers or something.
That's right.
And was...
Moonshiners.
Drinking a cup of coffee and watching TV, and some clown cuts in front of me.
Deer standing on the road.
A wreck, or a deer pops out in the road. Exactly how is this going to go? But the thing started with Tesla advertising for... some engineers.
Yeah, there was an engineer that they were looking to
have radar experience and so forth to try to handle the deer situation.
Yeah.
I think they're going to find it's a little more difficult problem than they think.
Yeah, an engineer responsible for developing vehicle-level decision-making and lateral and longitudinal control strategies for Tesla's effort to pioneer fully automated driving.
Tesla also has filed a patent, J.B. Straubel Design, for a hybrid electric vehicle.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Have you ever heard the like? Now, the backup isn't going to be an internal combustion engine, though.
No. What is it going to be?
Like a lithium air battery. Or a fuel cell battery. That, like the aluminum air batteries that we've talked about.
Yeah, okay.
That are, refillable chemically. Where you would normally go off your regular battery, but if you wanted to go long-range mode, you could engage the consumable battery. Okay.
Then you'll fill it up with its goodies. Okay.
That's just a patent filing. I don't.
Yeah.
I don't think that idea is viable, actually. I don't think it would make any sense, but we'll see.
Sure, absolutely. On the other side of good news is usually bad news. Mm-hmm. And Ecotality, who had declared that they may file bankruptcy back in August, filed for bankruptcy this week. So the manufacturer of the Blink and the Minute chargers and their network, Ecotality Network, wants to put all whatever they have left up for auction on October 9th. Nissan wants to keep them out there as long as they can, and then is asking the court to let them provide $1.25 million because I'm sure there's a lot of Leafs and things. Maybe there's some chargers at some dealerships, but it looks like Ecotality is going bye-bye.
And with good cause. There were a lot of complaints about the Blink chargers. People were arriving at them. And unable to use them.
Yeah, I heard they're in alleys and stuff.
Calling EcoColony and the technician saying, no, I'm showing it up. And, when the cord had been hacked off so somebody could go sell the copper.
yeah, so they're in so alleys. yeah, kind of a bad deal.
The Blink thing was in some disarray anyway. Kind of like the one in Israel with the batteries.
Oh, Better Place.
Yeah, that's the guy that's acquired that is kind of selling off quite a bit of it.
Yes.
Cars and so forth. These liquidations and so forth, I have been spending money like a drunken sailor, and I am hoping that you all will bail me out. this week, we acquired the remainder of the Azurodynamic shafted Siemens motors.
We did.
Some 100 of them from Siemens. And I bought 20 Codas, which I think we're going to get. I don't see, they're actually whole cars without batteries.
Yes, right.
And they're fully operational, which brings a tear to my eye. I don't see any future in putting these cars together as cars. We'd wind up with 20 grand in them.
Exactly, yeah.
And in a world of, you know, used Leafs that are already below 25,
yes.
Where you get warranty and service and so forth. So if we consummate that sale, we will part them out, largely to get the UQM Power Phase 100 drivetrain and e-gear drive, which UQM is still asking $15,000 for one of those motors and controllers. It's my intention to get it to work with the JEBQ.
Right, that'd be great.
Offer them at somewhat less than that, along with the chargers, air conditioning units, PTC heaters, DC to DC converters, and so forth. So we're kind of becoming junk man to the stars in all these liquidations,
all these new parts
and failures.
Though. Yeah,
but all these are brand new cars. They've never been. They've been tested.
Yeah, they hooked them up to a battery pack.
They hook them up to a battery, drive it around, test all the functions, take the battery out, and hook it up to the next one. The guy is liquidating them. And so in order to get a attractive price on them, we had to buy 20 of them. So I'm spending money like Obama. And it's
And yours is your money.
Hoping this is all important to you guys.
Yeah, that's right.
Because I don't need them. I've got plenty of motors and controllers. But it's an interesting kind of a small motor. It's like 11 inches in diameter and about 10 and a half inches long, and a pretty big inverter, but a permanent magnet type motor, okay. 100 kilowatt, about the same as the Siemens, really. But, you know, a lot of people wanted that drivetrain, and UQM has just been, UQM has made a heroic career of only selling to OEMs and giving everybody else a go-away price. Let's see, their first bankruptcy was with Phoenix, who was doing the pickup trucks in Arizona.
Right.
They followed up with somebody else, I can't remember who, and now Coda.
Coda, yeah.
And each time they get a little bit burned. They're trading about $1.65 right now on the New York Stock Exchange.
Ooh. Because at some point you get delisted, don't you?
Well, yeah, they've still got a little reserve cash. Okay. They're above a buck a share. But although they've been down to 75 cents. But it's my next stock play. I think they're going to be acquired.
Okay.
Don't tell anybody where you heard it. one of their big customers is EVI, sort of a Chinese truck company. I think they're going to buy UQM. And don't ask me why I think that.
That's right. And, you know, with BusCon this last week, you know, electric bus convention, I mean, it's just all kind of things going on.
An electric bus
convention. Yeah, BusCon. And actually, Phoenix was there. They have risen from the ashes like the Phoenix, and they're doing a like an electric delivery van and BYD and a couple of coach makers. Mm-hmm. So that bus market,
UQM keeps floundering around out there, sticking to their guns. We will sell no system before you pay triple. I have the numbers that COTA paid, and it was less than $5,000 for them for the motor and the controller. So once again, you have a arrogant and stupid entrepreneurial company that's about to go broke. In this case, I think they'll be acquired rather than declared
bankruptcy. Yep.
Good product. But they've made a specialty of selling motors and controllers only to OEMs who are about to go bankrupt. And
oops.
So we've picked up 20 of the Codas, and we'll have their units. Would you believe they require an NDA to sell you a motor?
No, and I've called over there, so they haven't told me that yet because I can't get anybody to talk to me.
Well, there's that, too.
they may ask for an NDA. They've got a great NDA going right now. They just don't tell you anything.
They
don't talk to you. That's right.
But, yeah, we're going to try and talk to them, but I think I can. we will get one of those Codas. That's all that's missing is the battery pack. We will get one of them running. And I will sniff some can, and we will figure out how that works, UQM.
That's right.
And we're going to out your ass. Everybody's going to know how your can bus works when I get done.
Yeah, why not?
It's you can NDA everybody else, but we're a publication. We don't do NDAs.
No, what did we talk about?
we're supposed to talk about it.
We are ODA. We only disclose.
Mm-hmm. We only disclose everything. And some stuff
we
really
make up.
Happened yet, and we kind of made up.
Made it up. That's right. Yeah. What the heck?
And so that's what else have we got?
It was just kind of interesting, and I guess it isn't really news, but it's funny. Automotive News, which is a big trade publication for the automotive industry, picked up a story. They started with a little joke. A Prius, a Chevy Volt, and a Tesla Model S walk into a bar. Mm-hmm. Which one gets to use the electric charging station?
Is this like when it was oxygen bombs?
Yeah, probably. They said even General Motors concedes that the Tesla should win this battle. Mm-hmm. So I guess there is an etiquette that some people perform. What you don't want to ever do is pull a Range Rover into an electric vehicle charging station. Mm-hmm. You may get your tires flattened. Mm-hmm. A Volt should maybe give up their space, is what they're saying. I don't know if that would ever happen. So there is this hierarchy anyway. So if you have a Volt, you're supposed to maybe get out of the way. Don't leave your car there too long. But battery electrics apparently rule. And even GM, and I may be able to send Jack this, has put together a little brochure that reminds you that there is an electric vehicle etiquette. Mm-hmm. So that was all just in fun.
Now they're shooting kids in the streets. We got a guy in the Navy Yard, shoots 12 people. Road rage, people cutting others off in traffic. But you think they're going to be polite about charging?
Don't think so. All hell's going to break loose over at the Chargers.
Yeah, I think so. I think that hadn't got a prayer.
The girl fight at the Chargers.
Yeah, right.
I just want to see it. Let's see what else. China has unveiled a new round of electric vehicle subsidies. Apparently, the one that expired in 2012, and I couldn't get what they were paying. It's supposed to be about $9,800 American dollars, U.S. dollars now. Didn't do much. So they're going to take another whack at it in China.
I think increasing it to try to get it to work, but it's not been popular there. I think they'll get some. I think Tesla will sell some. They have a rising wealth class over there.
Yes.
Bling. But I think the body politic is lacking in garages.
Probably, yeah. And I hear that like a lot of these suburbs that they're building, the houses are just not getting bought. People want to stay in the cities.
Mm-hmm. And so they're in high rises. Right. There's millions of electric bikes and scooters, but they can take them up in the elevator and plug them in behind the house.
Plug them in upstairs, yeah.
But an electric car, what? Where?
Yeah, imagine the mess of extension cords.
If you're living in high-rises, it's a little difficult.
Yeah, 600 foot.
They're actually, they have so many, a lot of car salesmen right now. They're having, in Beijing, you got to win the lotto to register a vehicle
just
at all.
To get some plates, yeah.
And they might sell a few just by exempting from the lottery.
Right.
Where you can go ahead and, if you didn't win the lottery to get a car this year, you can get an electric and get a waiver. That might work. It's kind of like the HOV lane. But China is coming. They're burning more gasoline all the time. Building, they now sell more new cars each year than we do. And it's still a very small percentage of their population that has vehicles. It's just a lot of people.
It is. Yeah, just a lot of people.
And they're building highways that are like 12 lanes, bridges and stuff that are unbelievable. It's kind of, the Chinese think this is their century, and they had kind of had me convinced.
Yeah, they're after it, I'll tell you that.
So.
They're after it.
We ought to go over there this year, next year.
Okay.
Let's just go to China.
All right. Anybody out there that wants us to come visit them?
We'll go see the Great Wall of Batteries.
Yeah, that's right. I think they have an Eiffel Tower now there, too, and maybe little bit of Venice and stuff, so it's almost like Disneyland. I'm ready. Okay.
I just want to go see all the batteries.
Yeah, that's right, the Great Wall of Batteries, huh? I didn't really have too much race news, but I did have this video. It's in the latest promotional video. It's a minute and a half from the Formula E, and it's just kind of cool. It kind of shows the cities where they're going. One of the Renault cars, I thought you guys might like to take a look at that.
Is about to start.
You know, I'm not a big race guy, but I do have a domain registered.
What do you have?
GreenPrix.com.
Oh, GreenPrix. There you go. Yeah. I forgot about that.
Yeah, GreenPrix. We may do a GreenPrix someday.
The GreenPrix. Then one last thing I had was the BMW i3. This is actually pretty funny. Mm-hmm. They've begun the production ahead of the November deliveries in Europe. Mm-hmm. They have claimed...
Yeah, let me work in an apology. I kind of ran over you last week. It was Washington.
Oh, where they do the fiber?
It's not a carbon fiber body factory. It's a company called SBF or SBE.
And it may be in here, too.
And they make carbon fiber and put it on a roll.
SGL Automotive Carbon Fiber.
SGL
Moses Lake, Washington.
Carbon fiber. And yeah. It is a joint program with BMW, by the way.
Okay.
BMW's got skin in the game.
Oh, okay.
But they produce rolls of the carbon fiber tape, and that goes to Germany, and they do the bodies there.
Oh, okay.
But it was Washington, which you were trying to tell me last week. Moses Lake.
Moses Lake, Washington, yes.
But it's a joint venture between SGL
carbon fibers.
And
automotive carbon fibers.
And BMW.
Cool.
And they actually produce the carbon fiber on rolls there. Body parts.
No body parts.
The body parts are done in Lands something Germany.
Either maybe out in Leipzig or someplace in Germany. To BMW factories. Yeah, they didn't say where, but
they
yeah.
did put out a surprisingly, I thought, informative, if barely narrated, unnarrated really, video of their production of the i3. I'm going to put a few minutes of this up here. It's a little boring, but I'm just going to put up the part where they actually show you while they're assembling their battery packs.
Oh, yeah. That's pretty cool.
And so,
I'm not too sure
what I was seeing there.
No, yeah, I know. It's pretty interesting.
Modules in a pan that goes underneath.
Yeah.
I'm going to go out on a limb here from what I'm seeing and say, I've seen this vehicle kind of panned in the press. I've even taken some pot shots at it, saying it looked like a Mini Cooper. Although that's not really a pot shot around here.
We really like Mini Coopers. Right.
And they're done by BMW. And so mine wasn't really a pan.
Right.
But I think they're not getting their due. This is going to be an under $40,000 electric car. Carbon fiber body, the kind of a new concept of the body being separate from the chassis.
Yeah.
Not a new concept, harking but back to 1905.
Going back, actually, but, yeah, to the frame and body. Yeah.
But some very advanced... kind of a neat mix, if you saw in that film, of people and robots.
Yes.
doing some very obviously something that's had a lot of design thought put into it, and how that assembly line is working to make their battery modules. But the same goes for their body panels of carbon fiber. I think that car, when it starts to show up, is going to surprise some people.
I think so, too.
I've always thought BMW would be Tesla's main competitor.
Yeah, main competitor, yeah, would be BMW, yeah.
But I think this little i3 may surprise you. I'm going to go out on a limb and sort of say I think this is going to be a winner right out of the gate.
Okay, cool. Well, that'd be great.
Germans are not buying electric cars. They've only sold about 1,200 electric cars over there. But I think it'll go here in the States, too.
Mm-hmm. I think so. I do.
And I think this car is going to surprise you. It may even surprise BMW. But under $40,000 and that BMW name on it.
That's,
and yep. Our experience with the Mini Cooper has been very good, actually. I like that car.
Yeah, it is
a
really good car.
I like everything about it.
Yeah.
And I think this is maybe a sleeper.
Well, I hope so, because that's what we need. The industry needs another good car
another
out there.
Another viable entry, yeah.
Exactly, yes.
And I think that's going to be put a lot of pressure on General Motors and Nissan in that price class.
I think so.
So
that's the news.
That's the news. Let's bring in EVTV EU and go for a boat ride.
Oh, all right. Let's do it.
Hello, EVTV. This week, New Electric is still waiting to get our Delta conversion out in the water with some pressure bearing issues that we'll get into in our next segment. We took out the Silverback conversion and attended Solar Boat Day or Green Canal Day in Amsterdam. Green Canal Day is an initiative to showcase some new sustainable technology developments sponsored by a couple of large companies, including Nuon, one of our energy companies that always sponsors the Luna Solar Challenge car. We have a local company doing a DJ solar bike setup, very Amsterdam, very hip. And a new player in the solar and sustainable energy space has bought a couple of Teslas to show how clean and hip they are. Shell always manages to push hydrogen here in a small one-person racer. A couple of jokers on the Segway. And of course, we can't just have roadsters. We have to have a Tesla Model S to show that. Moving on, and here is a futuristic bike. The local water supply company, Waternet, is pushing a new methane plant where we can charge cars from our own poo. At the end of the afternoon, it was time for Wibbo Ockels, one of our two living Dutch astronauts and organizer of the day, to speak to the crowds.
And then the hoofdsponsor.
And then it was time for the Solar Boat Parade, which people had come out to see. By 2020, the Amsterdam canals are supposed to be completely CO2 neutral, meaning all propulsion has to be electric. And to get some attention for this fact, there was a Solar Boat Parade Day, and we were happy to be the lead boat of the parade. And we're, of course, fielded a lot of questions about our solar our conversions, electric conversions, and services we could do for the companies with the canal boats in Amsterdam. There was a good turnout, as you can see, and most of these solar boats were projects by different technical universities throughout the country, often sponsored by a local energy company or a solar panels production company. And we took a tour down the center of Amsterdam and showing off the Silverback, and of course the solar boats. Hey, that's it for this week, and we hope to catch you with the Delta next.
And so,
how did he get to the front of the solar boat parade?
It's not a solar boat.
I know. How did he get up there? Lead the parade. He could hold more people.
You know how he got up there. No. It's the prettiest damn boat.
It is, man. That was a pretty boat.
They had a bunch of really ugly solar boats, and then this gorgeous mahogany deck, aluminum stiletto.
Yeah, real canal boat.
But I thought it was interesting. He was saying that by 2020, you can't have fossil fuel boats on the planet.
That was pretty interesting.
To me.
Yeah, me too.
Anna is on to something
I think so.
This boat deal. And that something like that could spread.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely.
I think this month they're having a electric boat convention in Nice. What date was that, the 19th?
Maybe the beginning of October.
Was it September or middle of October?
Yeah. Yeah, maybe around the 19th or something. Now next year they're also having a boat show in, I believe, in Amsterdam.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of
boat
stuff.
Well, they have a boat show in Amsterdam every June. We may go to that one next year with Anna doing the boat thing.
Yes.
But that's, he was the head of the parade.
I know.
So that's the kind
of get the wave down, you
thing
know?
We need going on is an EVTV EU build.
Yep.
Leading the boat parade.
That's right.
And so that's kind of interesting. I also got a video from our little buddy in Rancho Cucamonga.
Rancho Cucamonga.
Jehu Garcia is chilling out.
He is. Let's see. Do it. All right.
Hey, Jack. Of course, there's no, not a lot of happening over here this week on my car. Of course, all you guys know that it's not quite done yet. It's a work in progress. I did manage to do some stuff with the with the cooling system, and then I'll show you that later on in this video. But right now, the thing that I'm gonna do for the first time is I play in a little band, and just for fun, you know, we're doing a party for someone that we know, anniversary party. So I've loaded it up with all the equipment, all the PA system is like, I don't know, 4 or 5 speakers and guitar amps and a drum set and stand. I mean, a bunch of stuff. It's fully loaded. You can see there that it's, it's pretty loaded. It's pretty heavy. I'm not going too far. They live like a couple miles up the mountain here. So that's going to be the first time, and we'll see how the electric bus does fully loaded. It's going to be me and Gabriel here. He sings for us and stuff. So.
All right.
We're driving down the street. I'm not going too fast, of course, but but we're going to go uphill, so let's see how it does. Show them the mountain up there where we're going.
That's the mountain up there. So it's a long way up, huh?
Yeah, but when I talk was true, I said, brother, if you only knew, you'd wish that you were in my shoes. You just keep on using me until you use me up.
Like, you don't know if you're gonna run out of battery, you don't know if
the
steering wheel's gonna turn. go, Datsun. Come on.
That feels is good getting used. Oh, you just keep on using me. Until you use me up. Until you use me up.
I'm a new day rising. I'm a brand new sky and the stars upon the night. You see, the gig was all success. We had a great time. We played a few songs and everybody loved it, so it was good. The samba didn't break down. We didn't lose the wheel or anything. I also got a chance to install the chill plate that goes in the controller. I had a chance to go down to San Diego, and I made a pit stop at these guys at EV West down there in San Marcos. And Michael Bream showed me his split window BW transporter. So I'd like to show you that right now also.
So this is your Volkswagen. We're here.
We're at EV West with Michael Bream, and he's gonna show us his Type 2 VW transporter. Happens to be that we're both VW, you know, nuts, and I like my son, and he's got a split window too. So let's check it out. What year is it?
So we got a 1965 double cab, also known as a Doka.
Doka.
And we picked it up. We had to replace our shop truck. We just sold our Ranger, so we needed a little
something. The one back there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we just sold it to a customer. So we were really sad to see that go. So we picked this thing up about 4 months ago or something. Haven't really done anything. We were going to do a restoration, and I think we've kind of changed our mind. I think we're just going to paint it army green.
Okay. Pour 15 all bottom. Do you know
about
that?
Yeah.
Is that paint?
Oh, yeah. I got the Porsche project over there, so
yeah,
I'm pretty familiar with
415.
Yeah,
we backed this thing in this last time. Holy
shit. So I don't know if you know any of these guys. These are supposedly all like famous Volkswagen dudes that signed this thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, who knows? I haven't gone to all the transporter meets or anything like that. But we're excited. We're excited to get this thing running around. Just like a little shop truck for us.
It's got tons of room for battery right there. Look at that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's got that whole shell. Like, if you look under there, going back to where the rear seat is, you know, now the single cabs have the pass-through. They've got the side panels with the pass-through. This doesn't have that. It still has the space, but it doesn't have the cabinet door on the side for it.
Yeah. So you'd have to put them in there. But you wouldn't.
You're doing Baja racing or something.
Something to go over to the water jetters and pick up aluminum and all that stuff. So
go to the beach and put your surfboard on top.
Yeah, we were gonna. So he calls up Matt, and Matt's like, "Well, you're probably going into thermal cutback, you know?" And why? You know, I know it's hot out, but I got the. I'll bring it in. Well, sure enough, the water pump burned out.
Oh.
And it tells you how effective the plates are, because he can't drive it on the freeway for more than like a couple minutes now.
I tell you, I like 50 miles into my drive, just down to 35.
Yeah.
I'm like, and I check the temperature, yeah, it's like about 90
degrees.
So. Oh, yeah. This is what's going to allow me to go.
Hi, this is Michael.
Farther than 2 blocks. Right, so that's pretty much everything that's happening over here. I'm about to take off on a trip. We're gonna go to a VW show out in Jerome, Arizona. There's a classic VW show that happens over there. It's up in the mountains or something, and I think this is the last year that it's gonna happen, so we're gonna take the trip and go out there and just kind of enjoy the weekend over there. So I'll send you some video next week of that adventure. I'm sure we're gonna see lots of sambas there and lots of cool classic VWs. All right, so this is all for this week. Thank you.
I got the joke now. He was chilling out.
Well, yeah. And it, I mean, this brings up something. We don't take ourselves too seriously around here. I'm always kidding about the internet price match guarantee. Find a higher price and you'll match it.
That's right.
Jehu saved a few dollars. He didn't get his HPVS motor from us.
No.
And he got out on the freeway and it kind of heated up on him.
Yes, it was doing it here at the show, and it wasn't driving very much. Yeah,
I'm sure the reason he didn't buy it from us is because we charge more. But to tell you the truth, we don't ship HPVS motors and Curtis controllers without the chill plate.
No, there is no option to take off the chill plate. You only have an option to not buy our cooling kit.
Right,
but you get the chill plate for the price you see.
Mm-hmm. And if you go through our product line, and the astute have, the bottom feeders, I can count on them not to. They're always too tricky by
hand. Right, right.
But if you go through our line and you pick out the things, if you buy those things, what you wind up with is the thing you ordered in a box full of other stuff. Don't worry about it. Set the box of other stuff aside. You may not know what those things are, and go ahead and start to do what you were going to do. And three or four times along the way, you're going to wind up in a learning experience where you decide, you know, what I really need is a Flavus wafer.
Right. I need that.
I wish they'd have told me about that. And so then you go back and you order it, wait another 2 weeks until you get that.
Right.
In our case, if you go to the box and just rake around in the stuff, you might find one in there.
Right. You might just find what
and
you need.
And then go ahead with what you're doing. And when you get to the next place where you're stopped and you really need a... go back to the box and rake around in there. You just might find one. You see, one of the differences between us and a lot of these guys is we do this all the time. And we're not aiming to be the bottom price. I don't want to be known as the bottom price. We've got other people you can go to for that. But what always annoyed me was to install something and then find out there's no way to use it without this other thing. And it wasn't the expense, it was the time. The extreme example of this. And he actually, by the way, now ships them with because of me. I spent $4,750
I know this story.
$750 and waited a month for a Manzanita 75 amp charger. And when I got it, I found that the only way to set the voltage on it was through this little tiny hole the size of the end of a ballpoint pen.
Yeah.
And a 20-turn pot that was guarded behind there. And in his manual, which at least he provided some documentation, a lot of these things, they don't even do that. He's got in big red letters, do not use a little bitty jeweler screwdriver in there, and it'll completely void your warranty.
Right.
Because people were sticking it in and getting it passed and shorting out stuff on the board.
Damn.
And he has a whole description of a Vishay tweaker. I don't know what they really call them, but a little plastic. Right. What it is a tuning screwdriver that has a blade on one end and a recessed blade
right,
on the other.
A little shielded.
What they're really for is for old-time UHF radios because they were so you had to tune the circuits in them. And they were so high frequency, which today isn't even high frequency.
Right.
It's like almost low frequency. But in those days, it was considered high frequency. And the capacitance of the screwdriver would throw off the tuning. Where you'd tune it, you'd pull the screwdriver away, and it would go off. That's where this thing came from. Vishay makes it, I think. I always called them a tweaker.
Okay.
And they're all plastic, except for just a little bit of metal at the end. So you could tune those. They were like tank inductors or something in like a super het receiver for UHF. And if you used a metal screwdriver, when you pulled the screwdriver away, it went off frequency because it was so sensitive.
So sensitive, sure.
And we don't even have any of that equipment anymore. Nobody does that. Maybe me and Mark Weisheimer in the world would even know what one was. But that's what it was. So he has this whole page on how you have to have this thing to set the voltage. And here I am sitting without one.
Right.
And I can't use my brand new charger because you have to be able to set the voltage, obviously. And I can't without this device. And so I went and ordered one. It took 3 days to get it. And the device cost $1.75. The shipping was like $5.
Yeah, that's right.
So I got two of them.
Yeah, that's right. We splurged and got two.
And I have Rich on the phone, and I said, you know, it's got this thing, you require this thing. Oh, yeah, he told me the whole story of how they were shorting it out with a jeweler screwdriver, and he'd had so many returns and problems with it, and he was not going to warranty it if that's what came in, and yada, yada, yada. I said, so I have to have this to use your product. Oh, absolutely. Well, for $4,750... Do you think you might have thrown one in for $1.75? I mean, if you order a dozen of them, I think they're only $1.35. Would that have broke you? And so today he does. Your Manzanita chargers come with a little tweaker. I did that for you.
There we go. So we're always helping you out.
This is some of the stuff you get. And you know, we've got people all over the world doing this. And let him in. And... ordering stuff, and then to get it and have to go back and get it again.
I know, and it's
is the thing.
It's more the time, like we were saying with the parts.
Jay, who learned a valuable lesson there, and that is that cooling is a deal.
Cooling's a big deal.
You will not run as good and as strong without it as you will with it, and particularly with Curtis is where we learned this.
Yeah.
But I learned it again. On the thing.
Oh, okay.
Let's take a look.
Take a look at that. All right.
All right, we're here with the thing, and we're continuing to work with it and the generalized electric vehicle control unit. I'm extremely pleased with how that's coming, and our Siemens motor and DMACH 645. I have to tell you, I had a little bias against the DMACH 645 from the old Selectria days. Azure Dynamics started out as Selectria, and they did a car in 1992 called the Force that was based on the Geo Metro. And they did several cars. The Sunrise was a prototype. And they did sell motors and controllers into the DIY community. However, the AC24 and the AC90 was kind of problematical. The support was a little iffy and kind of surly, actually. So I didn't really warm up to this company. We never did a build with their AC24 or AC90. So I kind of had a bias against this inverter. But I have to tell you, it's working extremely well, and I'm warming up to it. I think the Gen 2 version has kind of... had some things. Colin Kidder and Ed Clausen have done a marvelous job on this generalized electric vehicle control unit. And the result, our test bed is the thing, and I'm very pleased with the way it drives already. There's a lot of little things we can do. One of the issues is the fill port for the gasoline version of the thing. It's located right here, so it made sense to us to replace it with our J1772 connector. Jimmy, you want to hop in the thing? And
yes.
I'm going to plug in the plug. And that's in the morning, and you've just come out and hopped in the thing to take off. Can you see this cord?
Not at all.
No it's chance. Kind of on the wrong side of the vehicle. And so the problem with that is, if you're a doddering old man like me, it would be fairly easy to turn on the key and drive away and rip our Clipper electric vehicle charge station right off the wall. And that can be embarrassing. So we want to devise a solution for that. There's kind of one worked out for us. We're using David Kurzel's AVC2 .R with his aluminum J1772 port. And this handles the proximity switch and the pilot signal for the EVSE. So our wall unit, any of them, will come on. And it does a good job of that. He's added a little relay on it that has a normally closed contact, normally open contact, and then the CE or center contact. We're going to connect 12 volts to C and run a wire from the normally open contact of this back to our generalized electric vehicle control unit, the GEVQ. And it so happens that I think pin 33 is D1 on our diagram. That's actually set up right now in code as a disable signal. And it will disable our GEVQ to not send any commands to the controller. Jamie, would you fire up the ignition?
Yep.
And put it in idle or neutral. And I don't want a lot of it, but just let's see if the motor will spin up. A little more pedal. Oh, put your enable switch on. So you're driving away in the morning. There we go. Okay, that's plenty. Let her spin down so we can get in and do this. And to test our installation, I'm going to plug in our J1772 cable. Now give me a little pedal. Floor it. Nothing. And let me unplug this. And now see if it'll turn a little bit. And so we have, let's shut her down, that fan noise. We have successfully interlocked using this little relay and an input port on our GEVQ, charge port. So if you have a cable hooked up to it, you can't drive the vehicle away. And so if I get in and nothing seems to work, maybe I'll get out and check and see if the cord's hooked up. Let's take a look at something else. The VW thing was actually the Volkswagen Type 181 Kubelwagen. It was produced from the Second World War on, and an interesting thing happened in Europe. NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, decided to build a utility vehicle across a number of countries, Italy, Spain, France, Germany, and they all got together and formed a committee to design this thing. And they decided to buy a few Kubelwagens for their utility needs until that was completed. 30 years later, they still hadn't produced any acceptable prototype out of this designed by committee thing. And in the meanwhile, they had purchased, I think, about 180,000 Type 181s. It was introduced in the U.S. as the thing. In 1973, and it was here for 2 years. I think they only sold maybe 24,000 of them. In 1974, they added this section. Now, the thing purists call these muffs. I call them hips. Looks like hips on the back end of it, and it has a vent here. Of course, our DMACH 645 is liquid cooled. So is the Siemens motor. Now, one of the things that we get out of going AC and liquid cooled is, frankly, we have gotten to the point where we can put enough batteries in a car to go on the freeway for an hour or an hour and a half. I found a little 13 miles up the freeway and get off and quit blowing air over it and then get back on the freeway and 13 miles back is actually at the point where I get off and turn around, I'll have a motor heated up pretty good. Just going down the freeway at 60 or 70 miles an hour. And so with our DC motors, we're getting into a thing where we actually build up quite a bit of heat. And as Jason Horak has demonstrated, you can actually melt the net gain right out of the car if you weigh it down with enough batteries and drive it far enough. And so looking to the future, I'm kind of becoming a fan of AC, and particularly liquid-cooled AC. Because we have a HIP on each side, and for no other reason, we bought two Summit Racing heat exchangers. We carry these in our online store. And we put them inside here such that they suck ventilation down through these vent ports and into the engine compartment. And that's how we cool our fluid, is through those two fans. Jamie, would you turn those on?
Yes.
Turn on the ignition. Problem is, there's what they sound like. Now, we all enjoy the quiet peace of the electric vehicle. In this case, and with liquid cooling, I have a tendency to get fans that howl like banshees. And you may turn that off now. And so you can hear what it sounds like. The DMOC 645, we procured a number of them. There's also a bunch of them rattling around on eBay and in the UK and so forth. I haven't gone to great pains to mention it, but those are not going to be very useful devices. First, they come with no software at all. You have to flash them, which is quite a process. You have to get the Azure Dynamics software, which is no longer available, and the Kavazer CAN bus adapter, which is kind of pricey, and flash the software on here. But there's also some settings inside that software, once it's flashed, that have to be changed in order for it to work at all. No one has decoded some of the challenge and response issues that were built into the DMOC 645. While rattling around in there and checking that out, I found a two temperature settings for the fan. And pin 16 and 17 of the amp seal 23 on the DMOC is actually a 12 volt out fan signal, purportedly. And so by setting that temperature, and I accepted the defaults, which was the fan was to come on at 39 degrees centigrade and go off at 34 degrees centigrade, I thought that we could use that fan output to run these fans, and so it would not come on until I got to temperature. We wired it up that way, wired a little relay to switch the grounds to the fans, and connected it to pin 16 and 17 of the DMOC. And I took off down the freeway and learned a number of things. First, it didn't work. The fans never came on. Second, I did overtemp the motor and the controller. We got up to about 135 degrees Fahrenheit, which is close to 50 degrees centigrade. 55 degrees centigrade, I think, is the magic number, and that's probably what we hit because it actually went into kind of a limp mode. I drove beautifully up the 13 miles, pulled off the freeway exit ramp, looped underneath, and came back up, and just that little period where there was no great airflow through it. By the time I got up on the freeway, I could only do about 45 miles an hour. I went about a mile down the road, and it seemed to cool down a little bit from the airflow passage, and I could get it up to 50 or 55. But all the way home, it wasn't quite the vehicle I had driven away from the shop. And so liquid cooling is, now there was the pump going the whole time. I had liquid cooling. But without the heat exchanger fans, it was inadequate to the task of running this system on the freeway. And so I do need the fans on. And so we've learned that, at least at this point, unless I can find another setting to enable the fan output, that they probably were not using the fan output on the Hazard Dynamics, and it may not even be enabled in the firmware. So we're going to have to do that in the generalized electric vehicle control unit, which is not a bad thing, because many of the other power electronics, inverter switches that we might use with the GEVQ, I don't know that we can count on them to have a cooling output. But most of them do report their temperature. Actually, the DMOC reports its stator temperature of the motor, the rotor temperature of the motor, and the temperature of the inverter. And so we can capture that data and make the determination and set our temperatures in the GEVQ. I'm going to have to write a little code to do that, but I'm confident it can be done, and we'll use one of our MOSFET outputs to switch the fans on. But thus far, the fan output of the DMOC, I can't get to operate. Maybe one of you all know the magic switch in the CC shell to turn that on. If you do, my email is available. But I think really we should move it to the GEVQ anyway, because I think most of the inverters will report their temperature, at least the temperature of the inverter, and we can use that to switch fans on and off with the GEVQ. And that kind of illustrates between the fan and the J1772 interlock some of the things that we'll be able to add really quite easily to the function of our electric car without really doing anything in the power electronics or the firmware there. And so that's where we're going with this, and part of the reason I'm so pleased. Colin has meanwhile done me a version. Right now we have also have an enable signal on D0 pin 32 on the input to the GEVQ, and he's requiring that to operate. I've got a switch on the dash that will turn that on, but so I have to turn on the ignition and then set the switch before I can go. That's a very safe feature, but it's not very automobile-like. You don't normally have that in a car. So he's going to write that out where I don't need that signal to, and you can't have it on at the same time it comes up. It doesn't work that way right now. So we're going to fix that. He's added functions, recall our welded contact and our pre-charge relay. He actually believes that the place to do that is in the GEVQ, and after seeing what he's done, I agree. You can enter the capacitance, in the case of the DMOC, 10,800 microfarads. The size of your resistor, in our case, 200 ohms, and he uses one of the MOSFET outputs to close a relay to apply precharge to the DMOC 645, and then another to close the contactor once it's gone five time constants, I think, to apply the full voltage to the contactor, and disengages the precharge relay. I like this because we don't have the constant 30 milliamp drain that we would normally have the way I had done it, where whenever you have pack voltage and have it hit the slap switch, you're constantly precharging the DMOC and holding it up there until you turn the ignition switch, turning on the main contactor. The problem is there's a 10 kilo-ohm resistor in the DMOC that's constantly draining about 33 milliamps out of my pack. And keeping those caps charged, which is kind of dangerous in a maintenance sense. If you go to disconnect some of those cables, you can get a pretty nasty jolt from 10,800 microfarads at 300 volts. That'll make your breakfast tingle. And so this will be safer, and it will eliminate that 30 milliamp constant drain on my high voltage pack by doing the pre-charge sequence in the JivQ. And so I like that function. Finally, he's given me back regen on the brakes, and with a min and a max I can set, and that purportedly doesn't make my throttle go away. So I'll have regen both on the brake, kind of power brakes, and I've right now got kind of heavy regen on the throttle, which is how the Tesla Model S comes. And I've gotten used to it, and I can actually stop the car with the throttle, and that works pretty well. So that's some of the small items that we're working off gradually to make the thing a more drivable car. And I have to tell you that the roughly 144 horsepower is what we measured at EVCON in this VW thing has been amazing on the road. It's truly a pleasure to drive. I was a little concerned about the Siemens motors in all of the test videos and in our bench test. It seemed to have some rattles and harmonics that were disturbing to me. You put a clutch and pressure plate on it and make it drive a car, it's smooth as a baby's ass. This thing just slides oily through the water. It's absolutely a pleasure to drive, and I'm really getting a kick driving around in the VW thing. Stay with us.
Oh, I didn't know that the cooling fans weren't coming on.
Well, we rigged it up to take advantage of a fan output of the DMOT 645 that's apparently not enabled.
Yeah, okay.
And I'm not sure how to enable it, but in any event, it should probably be done in the JevQ.
Okay, yeah, that'd be a good place to do it. Yeah.
What struck me was how gracefully it limited current.
Yes.
But it would be the same thing for many first-time builders. They would get out on the freeway and say, man, this thing feels good in town, but I went out on the freeway and it just didn't have any guts.
It didn't have anything, yeah.
No, it didn't have any cooling. I've driven them enough where I instantly recognized it.
You were in current limit, yeah.
I'm in current limit, but the first few times this happened to me, I'm like, well, that's disappointing.
Yeah, right, yeah.
It just didn't have it. Yeah, cool enough. What it had was it was limiting current because you'd exceeded a thermal threshold. And if you can get that heat away, that goes away and you'll find that you have a delightful vehicle.
Yes.
But not when it's limping. And so we have actually cured 12 or 15 people who were disappointed in their power of their electric car, that it, in every case, was either a battery voltage set too high.
Right, right.
Where it was limiting because of the battery voltage, because they didn't realize it went down.
Right, when you drove it. Yeah.
And, or thermal. And so, good lesson for Jehu. I'm still waiting to see his, this guy does some beautiful stuff for cameras. I'm hoping he can apply that same bling factor to a whole effect throttle for us.
Oh, yeah.
For our product line.
Yes,
and I think some of his anodized aluminum camera stuff, if he would simply pick up a Hall effect sensor and a spring and then make a piece of art pedal.
A really beautiful pedal,
that would be very cool. The VW thing is... continues, and there's our buddies at EV West. They didn't show Hob, my protege, but he was complaining about how the trailer was parked. and they have a single cab VW pickup out there. Not that handsome one yet.
Yeah.
Need a can of spray paint on that puppy here, Michael.
Some primer, some spray paint.
But, it was looking good. So that was Yehu making another trip to get the rest of his AC50.
Yeah.
Had you bought it from us, it would have come with it. And again, what you want to do is get you a cheap computer-derived cooling system from one of those guys out there. There's several of them selling them. They have a little radiator and a little
fish tank pump.
Little fish tank pump and a little clear plastic tubing and stuff. Run that a while, Jehu, and then get on the website. We've got a big boy cooling system. It's not cheap, but you'll see why.
But it works.
Can't stand to have leaks in an electric car.
No, that is kidding.
It just gives me a chill. So.
Yeah, that is not supposed to happen.
Summit Racing Bling AN fittings, overflow tanks, black nylon hose, Lang pumps.
Gotta love it.
That's what we use.
Yeah.
There's a reason we use it, guys. We've tried the cheap ways, and they're part of our history, not part of our future.
That's it.
You don't have to make every mistake yourself, Jehu. I've got 200 videos up there. If you spend a little time reviewing them, a lot of this will become clear. We should probably retitle them Ass Clowns with EV, but we like EVTV.
That's
it's
right.
More dignified.
Right. We're just going to stick with
that. Nothing you've done or about to do that we haven't already hosed up twice.
Yes.
And including going into current limit
yes.
with our Siemens motor this month. Brain, why is it I do all the work around here?
Well, now that the show's over, I'm finding the EVCon and waiting, just kind of ramping up for 2014. Remember, that is next August, the 12th through 17th.
We've got 30 people signed up already.
We do, and I think four or five cars. Yeah, mm-hmm. we've got some nice signups already.
Yes, it's September. We're talking about next August, and but the people who attended are pretty firm on coming back.
They're booking. That's right, they're booking. So I've got some of my day back, and that means being able to move forward on the Carmen Ghia project.
Ooh. Have you got stuff to show?
We do. We have stuff to show. Some things I'm readily embarrassed about, and some things that I'm getting proud about. So let's go ahead and take a look.
Let's go see what the thing is with the Ghia thing.
The Ghia thing. All right, so here we are at EVTV over in the Carmen Ghia corner. I know we haven't had a lot of updates, and we're going to change all that now. Work is progressing. I've been getting a lot of emails from people saying, what about the Carmen Ghia? What are you guys doing with it? What we've been doing is cleaning it up. We told you after we first got it that there was some rust issues, and there are. So we are ameliorating those as we speak, mostly by taking the rusted pieces out and replacing them with other panels. Some of them are some support. We're having to rig some other items in, some cross members, etc. But our goal is not to paint the outside of the car. It looks pretty good. Mm. Most of the rust is around the pan area, the footwells, a little bit in the back, and we'll show you some other place where we found it. But it's not that bad. Jamie this week started the first of the electric, the EV build. We just couldn't wait. We had to do something.
Shane asked me to.
Yeah, so yeah, the guys are just going, come on, if we do something electric, maybe we'll, you know, feel better. And we did. We feel a lot better now. So we used the stock gas filler area, which we just sawed out of there. This is cool in a VW, unlike in the thing, where it's welded. The filler pipe is welded. Here, it just fits through two big grommets and it's held in place. And it actually, we just cut it in half and pulled it out. So we didn't have to do any body work. So how did you affect this beautiful installation here, Jamie?
Well, simply just made a plate to fit, lined up my holes where I wanted them, got that initial plate all fitting nicely. And then I was able to center the actual J1772 inlet to where we wanted it and all bolted up, and she's nice and strong and functional. Looks good.
We should test it. Make sure that the cord goes on.
Oh yeah. Testing is always good.
Yeah. Let's see if the cord goes in there. Nice. Okay. Look at that. So we are J1772. At least our receptacle is in our inlet, and it fits under here. We can go ahead and close that, no problem. Just pop in here, spring it open, and we'll do some other stuff with it. Jamie's got some ideas, and we'll give you another update. You know, we can't help but bling it up a little bit. So it's just It's okay. We like doing stuff like that. Let's show you some other things we did. All right, so the next thing is, you know, VW doors don't like to stay open unless they have the door stop, and they're kind of a pain to do. We'll show you in a close-up, but basically what you have is you have this rubber item here, and inside the door are these two rollers and pins, and then another pin here to hold it to the body. What happens is, as you open the door, this comes through here and it catches right there, especially, and holds the door from closing on you. There's enough force of the door that'll drive these pins, and the rollers will just roll it, and that's what it looks like in a closed position. The thing is, it's a pain in the butt to get to, and that's where we found a little bit of rust as well. It's way up under here. I'm going to try to show you, but this door now is done. We just got the pin out of the other one that was frozen in, but it's two pins and rollers. You put the start with a narrow end, put it up here. It takes a little while. There's a couple of little circlips on the bottom, but now we have a door that will stay open, and we have a door that will close nicely and should stay open. It's kind of up in the air right now, but as you can see, at level ground, it'll be perfect. But it's looking pretty good. So Jamie has been helping on the front end. I think after he got the J1772 in, we decided what we're going to do with the front. There's a lot of room in the front of the Karmann Ghia, really more than you have in a Volkswagen. There's a couple of big horns in there, then a Beetle. You know, the fuel tank is gone. We do need to spray in here so we can stop any other rust. Our wiring limb was on some kooky thing that they made up. I don't even know why. We've got it somewhere. I'm so embarrassed of it, I don't even want to show it. They just covered the fuse area where the fuse block drops through from the trunk and stood it up at attention, and I don't know what they were doing. So we're going back to that. We'll run another fuse block off there that will power our mains. Will also give us some more opportunities for our EV equipment to run. So what show them what you're thinking about.
Yes.
The trunk.
Yes.
Or I guess, as Rich likes to say in Tesla, the frunk. We're gonna be frunky.
Initial plate will probably be permanently mounted, this one.
Okay.
We could have it so it's removable as well, but we're using the existing bolt mounts for the gas fuel tank.
Okay, yeah, there's four mounts for the fuel tank. That's cool, and they're in good shape right there, and they're strong.
This second cover will be quick and easy to remove and slide in and out.
Okay.
Also using two of the four mounting points from the fuel.
All right, cool. And what material were you thinking about with these? Were you thinking about a metal?
Yeah, definitely.
And then were you thinking something maybe clear? If we
if
we put any maybe equipment down there or something,
and we want to still be able to see it and show it off.
Sure. Okay. So we could do that. So instead of a flat plate that may be metal and hiding, maybe some components we never get to. If there's something we want to see down there, we may put a clear piece. Okay.
Yep. And this will be the same metal as that first one.
Okay. And that gives us access to our steering column, our steering box, all just like regular, all of our ball joints, or everything that we need in the front end, the master cylinders, and we'll probably end up having a couple things mounted down there as well.
Yes, yes.
So that'll be great. And then up here, what are you thinking? Something to cover this?
Well, that's probably going to be out of
maybe like some black plastic or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's just a rough template for the moment.
Okay, but I mean that cleans it up quite a bit. I mean, I like that. I like that look. That rib really cleans it up. We've got access there, and we will have some other things up here. Charger up here, DC to DC converter. We've got enough room to keep the weight balance correct to do maybe 130, 140 pounds up here, because with a spare tire and a full fuel tank, that's about what you'd be looking at in front of the Karmann Ghia. So we're gonna try to do 130, 140 pounds of stuff. But I like the way it's coming along, Jamie. It's looking good. Yeah. Hey, Rich, have you seen Shane?
I can't find him.
Where I hear some. Oh, there he is. Shane, what are you doing under there?
Oh, I'm trying to get this shift rod out. Let's see.
Oh, man. The old VW shift rod.
Oh.
There you go. Oh, look at that. Okay. All right. So this is the shift rod. So this runs from your shifter back through the tunnel and connects to the nose cone, the transmission, and it operates the shift fork. So when you're shifting, like if you hold this, here's like, let's say you're in first, second, third, fourth. It's actually rotating the shift forks inside the transmission. They're catching different forks. They're coming up. They're going back. You're dropping this, pushing this down to catch reverse. This is where it couples to the transmission. So on this end, right here, it couples on there, and this is what screws into the transmission. Along this, about right here, is a nylon bushing. And it's on a hanger and sitting about right there. And there's a hanger coming down from the inside of the car with a hole in it that's about this big, and it supports this side of the shift rod. There's also a little keeper on here. Mm-hmm. These are a total pain to put on. The one, ours was in two pieces, and as you can see, this is not a two-piece bushing here. So what we're going to do is we're going to sand this down or wire brush it down real good so it's real nice and smooth. Probably end up even maybe emery clothing a little bit. We're going to lube it real good. We'll have put this in the hanger with this keeper on it, which actually goes in the front in the, into the hanger. And this is where the hanger goes in. It guides through it. And then basically we have to be real careful from the front of the car. I guess we have to go this entire length up to about here without having this thing pop out of the hanger. Yeah. And they always do.
Always do.
Yeah, it takes four or five tries to do it. But this will make its shift really nice. It'll feel good because it was loose, it was broken, and it's just a pain in the butt. So we got a couple of these just in case. So that's how we're redoing the shift rod in the Karmann Ghia. Mm-hmm. All right, so we're trying to get this shot for you here. The dash. We took the dash off. It had a black plastic cover on it. It had a padded dashboard on it. It had a little under dashboard on it. It had a glove box. There was a paper glove box, an original one that was all torn apart. So we've got a new glove box. Our thought is to cover this in a wood, to do a wood dash in this, because these Karmann Ghias have a lot of holes and a lot of marking holes. When I did my 74 and did a cowl look, just cut all of this entire dashboard out and just made a flat dash. Mm-hmm. So it was really easy to do, but we're going to keep the look of the dash, try to do a vintage look, keep a vintage look with the car. We won't be using some of these holes where the fresh air was and where the seatbelt warning lights were and things like that. A toggle switch for the heater. So we'll be able to put our gauges and things where we want. Also, opportunities to run for air conditioning and our heating system. Mm-hmm. We talked about doing vents. Mm-hmm. So if we start with a fresh, clean dash, I think that we are going to find some opportunities for our air conditioning and heating system. So that's, I know you can't see a lot, but just wanted to bring you up to speed in terms of what we were thinking with the dashboard. Well, all right. So batteries, huh?
Yeah.
Electric vehicle needs batteries. And 144 volts for our Curtis 1239 is 48 cells,
48,
right?
48, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we do have a consideration here. You know, the first thing that we did was just, you know, build a box. We actually have a nice area. We've got good metal up here to support. We've got lips here where actually a back seat or a cover would go. And we had one in here. We'd show it to you, but it was carpet and wood. And that wood would never support the batteries.
No.
The issue is, and we showed you the shift coupler and the front, the nose cone of the transmission. It all pokes through right here and couples right back in this spot, and a little plate goes over it. If you can't get to that, you can't do that.
Yeah.
So in terms of engineering and design criteria, we cannot cover this up permanently. There is no other way to get there. So what are you thinking, Shane, for a battery box?
Oh, I guess we're going to have saddlebags, have one on each side here.
Okay.
What, are they going to hold 24 a piece, ain't it?
Hold 24 cells a piece. Yeah. Okay, that'll give us our 48.
Yeah.
We will have to have a cable, you know, go across. There's nothing we can do about that. But it will give us, the way we've got this, the dimension, that it'd be maybe 17 and a quarter wide. Is that correct? By 21, and I think we've got about 40 inches here, 42 inches. So that means we're going to use 35 of it. That's going to give us 7 inches, and that is about the width
about perfect,
of this cover plate here, is about 7 inches. So I love it when a plan comes together. And so we are not going to fight with that one too much. I think that's what we're going to do. So we are going to go ahead and begin to configure the battery boxes, have those done. We'll send them over to Southeast Fabricating or to Tote, and start to get those made so we can play battery boxes, and we'll be one step further.
One step.
All right, so now the final update for this week anyway on the Car McGee. We are really excited. You can see it's, we're starting to grin. It's our faces have been frozen in a frown for a while, but we're starting to grin now, and it's looking better as we take stuff out. At one point, we just had to vacuum out some stuff, and it was like, we thought it was all junk. Yeah. It was, some of it was cardboard. It was just stuff,
just,
you know,
everything.
just kind of junk. So back here, though, we do still have some work to do. And what are your thoughts back here on this end, Shane?
I don't know, Brian. We're going to, I guess I'm going to try and square it off here.
Okay.
And cut some old metal out. And even up here, I'm going to square it off and make it real slick, and then put some reinforcing J-channel.
Okay.
On all sides, you know. And then eventually we're going to fill in the rust holes and wire wheel everything, and then cover it with nice aluminum, you know.
Okay. Okay. I mean, that sounds good. I mean, that's what we need to do, and it'll be strong. We'll get the rust out, and it'll look nice. I mean, that's what we need to do. You know, we just don't drive around cars that look like junk, and this is just happens to be one of those projects that we needed to spend a lot of time just getting it back to the EVTV standard.
Right, that's right.
Zero baseline, no rust, looking cool, and then going from there.
Yeah.
But that is what we're doing around the car. I want to show you one more thing. Okay, so this is most of the stuff now going into the Car McGee. The HP EVS AC75, the 1238 controller, the chill plate. There's a new dash cover, flat four, wooden steering wheel, a cool shifter. They call the Eliminator, again, flat four that used to, it was fashioned after the one, the Inch Pincher, one of the very first VW drag cars in the 60s. So you see we're trying to keep this vintage look. We've also, if you remember, we had the rack on here, the wooden rack on top and the luggage rack. That's all been refurbished. We have our DC to DC converter, Brusa, all the other parts here, brake lines, reservoirs, cutoff switches, speedos, grommets, windshield, grommets. We have brakes, new calipers, new everything, cables, everything is new for the car. You know, when you really add it up, it wasn't that much expense, to be perfectly honest, and the car's down now, and this is the time to do it. Our adapter plate, in terms of the clutch, we are using a super disc, which is a two-sided, I can't remember if it's ceramic and asbestos on one side or the other, and a 2,600-pound Kennedy pressure plate. Again, we have not configured it completely, but we do see one of these hot starts for hot water, probably the 120-volt one, though. This is one of the 240s, maybe a 120, but we've got a, that may not be the one we use. Our pump, our high voltage DC relays, our Moroso tank that we use for the water, for the heating, our fill bottle for the to cool the Curtis. So there's a lot of stuff in here. We're only going to do the J1772, and I'll use one of these the Tucson EVs. I think if I can get away with it, I may not be able to. Now that I'm thinking about it, this is the wrong direction. I need to go from I need to go from 110, a 15 amp circuit J1772. That's not going to work, but I will use it. And so this is, the stuff that we are going to begin to put in. There's our bling, our emergency stop that'll go in the dashboard. So this is kind of what Christmas at EVT looks like, and we're kind of excited to put it all together. It's we're getting there now, I think, when we can start nailing this project. We probably have a couple more weeks of repair to the car, and we'll get the battery boxes done in the meantime. And then this stuff, it's a Volkswagen. We all know how to do this stuff, so this is not that big of a deal. So we should have a Karmann Ghia here running pretty quickly, and I'm excited. I know the rest of the crew. I know that Rich and Jamie and Shane are awfully excited too. So we're ready to party. Well, there you go, a tour around the Karmann Ghia. So now you can see that there is a Christmas present size package of stuff that needs to be bolted in there. Mm-hmm. We are remediating the rust. You see our plans for that. Mm-hmm. We have Jamie has done a great in the front, I think, a layout for us to be able to put some shelving in there, if you will, and then a little base floor so we can bolt things to it, run our wires. Our dash is completely apart, mm-hmm. and we're starting to build that up. I think next week we're going to go ahead and get the battery boxes started. So I'm feeling pretty good about the project. Shane has taken care of a lot of the mm-hmm. a lot of the parts in terms of just the mechanics of the car. We're doing the brakes, and we'll get the transmission back here from Rancho. So we're moving, I think, moving forward. I think we're trying to get this done. Jamie would like to see this car roll before he goes back to Australia. Mm. So I'm going to try That's not to aggressive. Disappoint him. I've got, maybe 5 or 6 weeks mm-hmm. to do it. So I think we can do it. We're not missing any. It's not like we have to develop a circuit or do anything like the JevQ, which is, an ongoing thing for right now with the Siemens. So.
I'm not sure that's completely true, pardon. You got a great heating system we've got worked out, but air conditioning is going to be new stuff.
I'm getting the mock-up from Vintage Air. It should be here next week, so we can start working on everything. And we're working on the plumbing. We're designing it out. So we're going to get aggressive.
It's going to be a challenge to get all that in there. I have to tell you, despite the rust. Some cars just have a curve to them. The 550 Spider, the 356 Speedster, I just like the look of them. But I would say probably the prettiest shape I've ever seen on a car is probably the Karmann Ghia.
And Karmann Ghia is a beautifully styled car. Yeah, it really is.
It's the antithesis of the thing. The thing is so ugly, I kind of like it.
It's great.
And by the way, it's a head turner. Everybody in town is mauling us on the thing. I can't go anywhere. Jill's getting notes on her car at the university with the Model S. And so, frankly, a lot of this is just look at me. Some of these cars, it's just cool to have a car that everybody likes.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
And the thing actually qualifies, but it qualifies because it's so heroically ugly.
Yes.
No one would say that's a pretty shape.
No.
It's a pretty messed up shape.
That's right. It's a conglomerate.
Why didn't you do that on purpose? It's kind of the thing. But that Karmann Ghia, just the various slopes to it, come together into a very pleasing, just almost like calming feeling looking at it.
It's a beautiful car.
It's a nice line of a car. And of course, Brian has restored Karmann Ghias before in gasoline versions. So that's his build.
Yep, there we go.
What is it you're putting in it?
AC 75 and the 1239, so I have 144 volts and with the 100 amp hour calibs and the AC 75.
Well, that's gonna go pretty hard.
I think so. Yeah, I think it'll be fun.
That'll go pretty hard. The 100s will do 600 amps, 500 mm-hmm. amps easily.
Mm-hmm.
And what are you gonna try to make it work up around 170 volts?
Yeah, we'll pack as many as we can in there, and then we'll see what if we're limited. Mm-hmm. We can always take a couple of cells one at a time out and mm-hmm. see what we get.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So that's the plan.
All righty. Well, good work. I think that's exciting, and I'm pleased to not be the only savage on the buffalo hunt. Now yeah, you can have a segment every week.
I know. Yeah, we'll be doing it every week.
Carmen Gia, and what's going on there, and that'll give it a little variety. And of course, we've got Anna with the boat thing. He kind of ran into some problems with his bearings.
Yes.
On his motor mount. We'll see how that comes out. It's not easy every day, Anna. We try things and then we have to refix them and try them again. And how many heating systems did I have in the Escalade before you get to inherit one that works on the
few iterations, yes.
I think there were 5 iterations of that. And we finally got it worked out. It heats great. I flip a switch and my environmentals work just like Cadillac.
Yeah, no, they do.
Fortunately, my transmission doesn't, but we have suffered through the throes of the transmission experts and somebody found Performance.
You found Hughes, yeah.
We're actually going to get one with a lower
lower stall speed. Yeah.
Down around 1,000 RPM.
Yeah, their fuel miser torque converter.
I like that idea. We'll try that next.
Yes.
And see if we can get the Escalade back in motion. The Cobra.
That's right.
Net gain warp industrial, which has never precisely worked once in a row. Including Ryan's been out here driving it. He blamed all the ills on our refusal to have a lead battery. And we finally put one in. Nothing got better. And now it's was throwing a type 21 error, which is a DSAT error on the IGBT. So we've had to pull that and send it back to net gain drive system. Net gain control.
Net gain control. Net gain control.
It's not really a net gain the same with the motors. It's actually a different investor and Ryan Baum. And so hopefully we'll get that back and get Paul's
Cobra running
back in operation, which is very strange. He never comes and gets the car.
No, I know.
our guy in Taiwan that we did this for has threatened to kind of pick up this car every month for a year. And it's never left the lot.
No, it's still there.
But we've kind of worked out some of the DC to DC issues. Mm-hmm. And it does have a lead acid battery in it.
Yep, it does have a little one in there.
Paul and Ryan wanted one. They have one. It made no difference to the controller whatsoever. And then at Evcon, we did a couple runs. Controller gave up the ghost.
Yes, it did.
Quit working.
Yeah. It did.
And so that's, we have plenty of disarray. If there was some sense among you that electric cars do not require any maintenance, let me disabuse you of that notion right now. We've got most of our cars in work all at the same time.
That's right.
The Mini Cooper's down at the airport. I haven't even had time to look at that. It's not operational right now. So we're struggling to keep all our rolling stock on the road. Part of it's my having the attention span of a 4-year-old and playing with the latest thing,
the latest
shiny toy.
That's right.
But, we're going to have plenty of Siemens motors. Still a month away, really, on having maybe two, on having a hardware in quantity for our customers that have bought the Siemens and the DMOC. But it's getting very closer. And operationally, whether or not this was going to work, it works smooth.
Yes. Yeah. The whole system is really great.
We've still got some stuff to do, but it's... it's actually working quite well, right? It drives great right now, so
yes,
I'm pleased with it. And and better things to come. We're finding all kinds of little things for it to do.
Yeah, for the JevQ. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's going to be a great piece.
So another month, 45 days, we should have some boards, some hardware to spread around and let more people play and get their systems up and going. So that's where we're at. Stay with us. We will try to do this again next week. Do we have anything else?
Did we want to talk about your circuit out there, your BMS out that's ready, your spec?
I have on the blog, I published the specification for the EVTV competition to win the battery pack and build a battery management system. And it's published. It's a little bit whimsical, but it's on the blog. Yeah. You can download it. We already have a number of people who have expressed an interest in making a run at this. We'll see what we get.
Okay, good.
And but I think the competition's going to go live. In fact, I'm surprised at the people that are signing up.
Yes, a little crowd out there.
So I'm happy to confer with anyone who wants to talk about it. The spec is a wish list. It's not a papal decree or religious document, and we already, Jeff Southern's going to make a run at it in a completely different way.
Okay, all right.
And that's okay. We'll see what happens.
Right.
I don't have a lot of axes to grind here. We want to wind up with a thing that'll let you monitor some things and without burning your car down.
And be accurate with that chip using that.
Well, they don't have to use that chip.
Okay.
That was
okay.
Suggestion.
Just a suggestion. Okay.
We'd like an accurate shunt-based Coulomb counter. But if you can show me how to make Hall effect sensors be accurate at low currents and high, I'm all ears.
Yeah. Okay. There we go.
And so it turns out we've got some pretty... pretty steady engineering level talent among our viewership.
Yes, that's really
only $9,000 worth of batteries is attractive. After all, I wasn't sure.
Is it a little motivating?
Yeah. So,
absolutely.
Stay with us. We'll be here next week.
See you then.
Music maestro.
With the River Tales Classic Car Show. Appreciate it very much. Guys, we got Old Town Kate. We appreciate those folks an awful, awful lot. Guys, if you've never drove up and down some of these streets, check them out, guys. They're overhauling it, and I'm telling you what, we came down Broadway today, and it was really, really, really cool. And it's been a while since I've been down that way, so check them out as well. A lot of neat shops.
Yeah.